This evening, there is the launch of Big Country's brand new LP. It's called Peace in Our Time. And the launch is taking place at the Russian embassy.
This evening, what it's about is announcing to the world press that we're going to Moscow in a week's time. And it was at the request of the Soviet embassy that we initially held a press conference there.
The Russian embassy have kindly donated their services and inviting a few media people there to listen to the album, listen to Big Country playing live.
Hello and good evening. I'd like to welcome you all here this evening, the first time ever the band's played in the Soviet embassy in London. I'd say, hope everyone enjoys ourselves and hopefully this little thing that we do here tonight may lead to us all having a more restful sleep in the future. Thank you. This is called Peace in Our Time.
Inconceivable that a British rock band could be playing in the Russian embassy in London. 2 years ago, it would have been impossible.
The idea of playing in the embassy came about because the concerts mark a first for Moscow, in as much as that they're to be promoted by bodies which are not the traditional state-run organisations which promote entertainment events.
This is a very good example of glasnost and openness. And the band is perfect. And the music is perfect, and I'm absolutely sure that the future visit to Moscow will be a success.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it's a good thing from a news angle because this is the first time that a band has played in Moscow and hasn't been sponsored by the state. It's being sponsored by a separate promoter, rather like the big promoters we have in this country.
Concerts are actually being put on by the Foundation for Social Invention and in a sort of joint basis with a guy called Stas Naman, who's quite a well-known rock artist in the Soviet Union.
Well, Stas Naman, who is this sort of Russian Beatles figure, is helping promote this in the Soviet Union, this tour of big countries. And the only reason he's been able to succeed, he's sold 40 million records in the Soviet Union, is because his grandfather's on the Politburo.
We've always been aware of the fact that that music can be more than an entertainment form, that it can share ideas between people, that it can cut across cultural and language barriers.
We, the music business, should be a part of that. The music industry has broken many barriers and, you know, taken lead where others have feared to go, fed the world and done all those sorts of things. So yes, I think we should. The record industry should play a major part in exchanging cultures and exchanging ideas with the Soviets.
And around that time, the Reagan-Gorbachev summit was happening in Iceland. There was a lot of meetings and discussions on it. And the sort of idea entered people's heads, but particularly in Grant's head, what a great idea if we can do something to bring together different nationalities and bring together the East and the West.
The idea came about from being probably Ian Grant after a lot of vodka one evening.
Now, it wouldn't surprise me if in the next year or two, if Gorbachev had his way, there wasn't a bit more of an open market for buying records out there. And of course, you know, it would be a very astute move on their behalf to be out there and in there first, as it were. I mean, I'm sure your status quo were thinking pretty much the same thing. And I'm sure Elton John was thinking the same thing when he went. And I'm damn sure that UB40 were, because it seems to me that UB40 is the only band whose records you can buy out there.
I think they're also going because they think that they can achieve something by breaking into new territories. I think they're going because they'll be able to get some kind of feedback from Russian musicians and maybe learn some new things.
The band had always said they wanted to play in the East, Mark because of his Polish background, Stuart for different reasons, and it seemed to, at this one particular moment in time in Los Angeles when the album was being recorded, it seemed to all fit. Yes, let's go and do something in Russia.
There are probably two reasons they're going to Moscow. The first is probably a reason of conscience, and the second, it is a marvellous hype. It will definitely develop a great deal of interest in the industry.
Obviously, with a trip like this, there does exist the opportunity for people to exploit it to the maximum. That happens whether you play in Moscow or whether you play in New York or whether you play in London. I think it happens everywhere.
I think the bad thing about rock music, especially as regards people in Russia listening to it, is that it's a dreadful language, it's clichéd, it's appalling, and it doesn't really say very much.
If Big Country were a capitalist machine churning out inane rock, pop music to unsuspecting people who didn't want to buy it, then I might feel a wee bit guilty about inflicting this upon the Russians.
So may I present to you the group which performed so well only a few minutes ago, Big Country. Welcome.
I'm sure they know what they're doing. I think Stuart Adamson, you may say that his politics are naive, I think I've read that recently, and that he's a naive thing to do. But whether it's naive or not, I think he's wholly committed to what he thinks is perestroika, what he thinks is glasnost, and how he should help it. So you can't knock somebody that's sincere, really.
Well, I hope Big Country know what they're doing. I'm sure they do. I'm sure that if not the band directly, then the marketing people behind them know what they're doing, and they're being very shrewd about it.
Maybe Big Country is part of a mega hype, but I think theirs is probably a genuine desire to break through certain barriers. I mean, do they really believe they're going to make a pile of money out of Russia? I think the answer is no.
As a marketing media event, I think it'll be very successful, yes. I don't know how many column inches they're expecting to get. And in fact, nobody will guarantee them any at all.
It's definitely heartening to see the interest our very modest efforts to open up our country are taken up by the British press, by the British media, and we very much hope that we might continue our, in a very cooperative mood, our endeavours for a better world.
Thank you.
Please contact the airport information desk.
Any more passports?
Thank you.
Dealer Toronto, here's the man to sit next to.
Event of the weekend was a jaunt for around 200 media personnel.
There were 236, I think, in all, the whole plane load, but that was comprised of TV, radio, record company people, promoters.
This trip is a massive jamboree for the media. But there again, what other gig isn't? The media jingle that goes with Michael Jackson when he comes over here, or Bruce Springsteen. The media hype is part of actually what bands are all about.
As far as the being involved with the press junket's concerned, we people from the press will be the only ones that behave like animals when we're out there. The band won't.
I think one of the enjoyable parts of this trip is that nobody really knows what to expect. I'm just looking forward to it, because for most people who have never been before, it's going to be a completely new experience.
for some strange reason, probably connected with Gorbachev's political moves that weekend and the fact that the Aeroflot planes were coming in from all around the Soviet Union with the Soviet delegates, the plane was towed back onto the runway and no baggage had come off the plane. It sat there for 2 hours. No one could come through customs. Therefore, the whole thing had a domino effect.
Nobody wanted to complain in case they were whisked away by the KGB. But, I mean, it was incredible. There were a lot of sharing going on this trip. We even had to share a runway at one stage, I noticed.
Well, my first impression of Moscow was fear when we just missed the plane that was on the runway and we had to take off again, which was a nice welcome.
I must say, allocation of room keys and stuff like that was certainly nothing I'd experienced in any other hotel anywhere in the world or I'm ever likely to experience ever again, I think. It was a bit of, we've got some rooms and I think some of them are yours and if you stick with us, we'll get you your room before 4 o'clock in the morning. But we got there eventually.
To launch something in Russia or in Moscow is something that you can only do once or twice. It is something that, as far as we're concerned in the West, this is part of a media attack. It's not something that you can do 100 times. I would suspect that the media would get bored of this sort of thing. It's just another approach as far as they're concerned.
Inside, it's full of trepidation, really. You don't know what to expect. A lot of uniforms floating around. Which frightens you a little bit, yeah.
Coming from the airport to here, I thought the cars were on half battery power because they only had the side lights on, didn't they? And it looked a pretty dark, oppressive place to me.
The hardest thing to do, actually, was, first of all, finding a hall which was available because they're fully booked for sports events. Second thing is getting the hotel rooms because Moscow's got about 30 hotels too short. And the third thing was getting the visas, because you have to be invited. I mean, this is the biggest media junket since Ronald Reagan.
First concert's done, finished?
Yes.
Not six? Come back here for dinner?
Sure.
Things kept constantly changing. As soon as we agreed something, it changed. And a lot of things they told us had been arranged, hadn't been arranged, and it was like a mad panic when we got there to make sure all the details were finalised.
What do you mean by dinner, Stas, at 1 o'clock?
Lunch.
The gig changed for a start. We went from the Lenin Sports Stadium to the Sports Palace, which was for good reason, because they wanted to make it a stand-up concert, and it would be the first that they had, and so we were all for that. The hotels weren't confirmed, and then they said at the last minute they were confirmed, but 200 rooms become 200 beds. So that caused the first panic, because how we were going to pair everybody up.
To walk from here to Red Square, etc.
Unofficially, I don't know. You should go there and just ask me, because it's nothing serious. Why not to film Red Square? Everybody's filming. Yeah. Mm.
That's the reason. The reason I ask is that it's going to be more than one camera, right? There's going to be so many cameras. Yeah.
Oh yes.
Yeah, see, that's why. Yeah. So that's what we should try.
I don't know what.
Maybe with Gennady can help. Maybe Gennady can help.
People here seem very
depressed, very sad. It's very rare to see people laughing in the street. When we've been wandering around, it's, people look at us whenever we burst out laughing in the street. I think people are much more serious about their lives here, which they should be. I think the amount of bureaucracy and very pointless seeming jobs that are around is quite amazing. We did see someone in the metro system the other day whose sole purpose in life was to guard the escalators, which I thought was quite a fitting comment on the way that the system is run here. The valley sea has wandered for the load. Everything she is the one that she dreams over. But her bed was made elsewhere.
It's unbelievable, isn't it? It's like an old, well, it's an indoor market, really. It's extraordinary. What I think is weird is there's no kids hanging around. Like, you'd get in, like, Saturday afternoon in Milton Keynes, there'd be a few punks or something hanging around on a street corner. There are no young people here at all. No graffiti, no litter. Very odd.
The sort of place your pet shop boys would make a video, isn't it?
Very weird. Moscow evenings. Very interesting indeed, I'm sure. Now, what have we got on here? The Working Class is Marching, the first track is called. This is rather fine. Towards the Stars. What else do we have? Tenderness. There we are. Black Eyed Cossack Girl. What a cracker. Number one.
I think we should wander over Lenin. To the tomb, definitely.
Yeah, have a look at your Lenin.
Indeed.
A bit of a queue, though, but we're supposed to be... filing in a bit slow, aren't they?
We've got to find out what currency they accept on a door or whether it's free, although I wouldn't imagine it's free in this country.
Nothing's free in this country. Except the people. The
indeed,
people are.
Indeed. Yeah. I'll have two children then.
Yeah. It's moving quite quick. I don't think you can lawyer. You just kind of...
It's been a bit like... I think I've got a long memory. It's a bit like after the war. For us, you know, before the, like in the 1960s. I mean, this little thing here, that is the highlight of the suit there. You can see. I don't think it wouldn't have lived. Its eyes are too close together. But it's. Don't ask me what's in the soup. It seems to be like toad soup, but we're not too sure about that at the moment. But the lads had a go at it. It's been interesting. I think they're probably giving us the best that they've got. What we were just saying around here is, where does the good stuff go?
How about main course?
That's still twitching.
How about main course, Rob?
We saw it run past earlier.
I don't know which horse coughed this up, but it's rather pleasant.
I'd eat anything at the moment. Excuse me, I'm so hungry.
Okay, we've got it on film.
This project with this big country for us is not commercial. We are not going. We were not going to make money on it. We just try to arrange good time and comfort, not only for the musicians, for the audience and for the media people who came here.
A free trip concentrates the mind wonderfully. And people who might have thought, hello, what's come out this week? Big country, sure, there you go, bang, 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 know what to expect from that. They know what to expect now and they're going to come here and see it. And people are going to file copy and do videos as you are, and we're going to do some stuff about the trip. There's going to be a lot of coverage for the band, so it's not going to do them any harm.
And I think we have really very talented people now, talented musicians. Now, before Perestroika, they were underground, you know, absolutely forbidden, and they didn't have future. And now we're trying to do it. It's very difficult because we have the same people, the same bureaucracy even now. But now the Lord gave us permission to do something independently. And we're trying to fight with officials and bureaucrats. We have now our independent studio, not covering by Ministry of Culture, so they don't cut our lyrics, and I don't know, we can record what we want.
I suppose my biggest fear would be that people view it cynically. That's just a publicity stunt that was arranged around the album. It's not true. The whole album, Peace in Our Time, and the song and all that was written before the Russian, you know, event was even thought of.
It's the first time I had business relations with foreign professional management company, you know. And it was a good lesson for us because, you know,
In fact, I think we are too much naive here. We like rock and roll more than business, you know.
I don't know what's going to happen at the concert tonight, but I'll be very interested to know if wooing has got to Russia yet, in the sense that when they walk out, instead of them sitting here saying, yes, it's a group, rock and roll and so on, will they actually instinctively go, woo?
Happening, as they say. It's going not bad at all. We're having plenty of buzzes from outer space at the moment. It's not too bad. We've got to go back to analogue technology now, you see. Back to the good old days. Tomorrow we're getting the gas amplifiers out. And then we'll have the hamster technology.
It's going, I'm playing with my graphic at the moment, which enables me to get even well funky, you know what I mean? Well funky, that.
It's all here. This is my house. Visitors' entrance is round here. Appointments only.
Right then. I think black people in Russia is not as it's not as new as people might think. It's they have a lot of Cubans here, obviously, because they have the same political system. I think Cubans can come here easier than they can go anywhere in the West. So it's not that unusual being black in Moscow.
When we came in the other day, we had a photographer who, from here, who photographed everything, right from when the doors opened on the truck, all the way through, every event, as if to be able to recreate the same event in their own way.
Very, very slowly. Very slowly. Everything takes for hours, right, in this place.
We do a tour. What we do is do one gig. Nigel here records it on a Beta cassette, and then we just mine for the entire rest of the tour. It makes it very free and easy and very relaxing, which means you have lots of time left for party.
The original deal was
that we would give an album to the Foundation of Social Invention, where they would firstly recoup their losses, and profits thereon would go to the Afghan Veteran Rehabilitation Centre, which again tied in nicely with the album, because there's a track called Thousand Yard Stare on it, which is a Vietnam phrase.
Good afternoon. My name is Larry. I'm a Vietnam veteran and a recovering alcoholic.
Меня зовут Ларри. Я ветеран Вьетнама и выздоравливающий алкоголик.
Since we came here, we have met with many Afghansi, whom we now call our brothers.
С тех пор, как мы приехали сюда, мы встретились со многими афганцами, и теперь они стали как братья.
And with Mr. Gorbachev, we have a great hope for peace in our time, and we pray that Afghanistan will be the last war on this earth. Thank you, and God bless you.
Мы поддерживаем Горбачева и хотим мира, и надеемся, что война в Афганистане будет последней. Спасибо.
Спасибо большое.
Two words.
Big country lead singer.
Hello there. I'd like to say welcome to everyone.
Здравствуйте. Рад вас видеть.
Hope that the spirit of this occasion has repercussions not only here in Moscow but throughout the world. Thank you very much. Спасибо.
They also said that we had to have a festival on a Saturday afternoon with six of their own bands on, which I didn't really object to, apart from the fact I'd like to know more in advance. Didn't object to it because, again, it was in the spirit of what we were trying to do, exchange musical contact with the country.
It's very important for us to show Soviet rock and roll because it's difficult to break this iron curtain, you know, not only to Soviet Union, but even from, you know, to show what we have.
Голос вселенной врезает все сердце, делая жизнь бесконечной песней.
This is a singer. This a rare guitarist.
Very rare indeed.
Keyboard.
Yeah, yes.
This is one with no brain. We call him drummer.
Аллергия.
А милиции здесь вообще нет, мы специально просили ее убрать. Понятная ситуация, да? Просим вас не давить. Сегодня мы сделали такие концерты, и днем у нас фестиваль, где очень интересные группы играют, и завтра будет такой фестиваль, просим вас прийти, если интересно. А сегодня мы показали вам одну нашу команду, которую я люблю больше всех, честно говоря. А сейчас выступит очень красивая группа, которая играет великолепно. Она неизвестна у нас в стране, но после этих концертов мы надеемся, что будет популярна. Big Country!
Hello and good evening. Hello. We're called Big Country. We're from all over the place. This is called Peace in Our Time. Excuse us a minute, we have an equipment malfunction here. Languages too, and gear that doesn't work. Just like to say hello and good evening to you all. Hello, it's nice to be here. Thank you all for your very warm welcome. We'd like to play a song. Wait a minute, does anyone understand what I'm saying here? That's good because no one else does.
Underway here in our country. You know where all that
Such amount of people coming to this country and to not very official organization, and we had to organize all these people and to take them here and to feed them and to make them live at the hotel, and it was very, very difficult. This is the first experience in our center, such amount of people. It's very difficult.
The main thing is the fact that they obviously have difficulty understanding what they're singing about, blah, blah, blah. And
they found out in the end, didn't they?
So I think that considering all those things taken into account, they enjoyed themselves tremendously. It was difficult for us because of the fact that I don't think they really know how to... I mean, we all know how to act at a rock concert. We all go along, we all know that you have an encore and you all stand up and you all do various bits and pieces, but it's a first for them.
Not very many people can understand lyrics, but I think it's the main point of this kind of music.
But do you think they enjoy the music?
Yeah, of course. For feeling experience.
I would say it was a qualified success. At the end of the day, they managed to bring it through. The second half of the show was wonderful. I really enjoyed it.
There was a tense atmosphere. It was interesting. Was trying to marry East and West.
How did it get on?
I think they're trying to extend the courtship.
There was actually some problems with the phasing of the power. It was cycling at 30 volts higher and lower, and the equipment's tolerance would not...
So we had to go and get some equalisers, I was told.
Yeah, there we go.
Technical shit.
The candles actually got very close to the end of the wicks, and they had to change them.
Well, I think it's been great in the end. I mean, what can I say? I was buried twice, last night with the plane arrival and the malfunction of the equipment. But if one doesn't give up hope, I've lost my words. Have you seen them?
Talking to the Russians beforehand, going into the gig, and seeing how deprived they are from music, and, well, popular music anyway, to them, they couldn't understand the lyrics, they just understand the beat. And they know that the Western people like it and they want to enjoy it as well.
You saw them last night, bouncing up and down. Previously, the KGB have always been there saying, sit, and they've sat. Last night, it was like being in the West, like being in London or New York, and you had to realise that you were in Russia?
It was very sluggish. They were sort of, everybody worried about whether it's going to work or not. But it picked up towards the end. The last three numbers are really good.
And the young Russians were all sort of sitting on the shoulders of everybody and they were joining hands and going like this. I'm very surprised. I expected them to be more restrained. And they were very enthusiastic and, you know, more like a Western audience, really.
Great reception. It was well laid on. The food was good. Plenty to drink and a good choice of drink as well.
Yeah, and I think from the people that were here from Moscow as well really appreciated the band coming over. And I think that the big country have led the way for a lot more people coming over. I think it can do a lot for breaking down the Russian kids.
I don't know. Yeah, I wish I would have seen them. I like big country. They're cool.
Yeah,
I think they should open up and let more bands in.
The women really
I think
like
they should
them.
Have some hardcore. I think they should have the Meat Men. You know the Meat Men? Meat Men are hardcore, man.
We thought it was very good. We enjoyed it a lot.
What about the problems?
Well, technical problems. I prefer to get a good show at the end of the day and have to wait a bit. What we were talking about just now is the fact that the people are not allowed to smoke during the show. And if you go to the loo, all the guys are there, like in school, smoking behind the door. Which is quite funny, actually, because we didn't realize it, and we were just smoking anywhere. But anyway, we had a bit of a laugh with that. And after that, we had a great party. It was really good fun.
So they said there was something wrong with the voltage, because I wonder if those problems could have been resolved beforehand or something, because it didn't, you know, I mean, it wasn't good for the band to go through all that thing. I think the fans are a bit upset about that. Like, we went and interviewed a few of them, and they said they preferred the Russian bands because of that, you know, at the beginning. But afterwards, I think they got the hang of it, you know, when the band came on, they obviously really enjoyed it. This is an objective viewpoint, so no...
Heckling from the side, from the manager.
This is a very. Can you see the hecklers, please? Yeah, it's a very strong management contingent here.
What?
Keep going, Bruce. Keep going.
No, I'm going down this way. I'm going to watch the silly walk.
These guys are really scary when they walk like this, aren't they?
I'm glad I came, you know, because it was not the kind of thing you would do normally, so it's a good opportunity for everyone to come over here, and I think it worked well for the band, you know. It's a bit of, I mean, it's a good hype for them as well, get people interested in the band. So I think from that sense, I think the record company are pleased, management are pleased, the band are pleased. I don't know if they're going to be able to sell any records here. I wouldn't have thought so. People find it hard to buy tomatoes, let alone records, so, you know.
It's very easy to be cynical about such things, but I think when you look down there at people's eyes and see them jumping about and being involved in the songs, I think, yeah, it did work very much so, yeah.
About second full start, the band came off again. The bloke from the Sunday Sport came over and he said, oh, Christ, he said, I hope they play. I said, no, why? It'd be great if, you know, if they don't play, it'd be a brilliant story. He goes, no, because Sunday Sport comes out tomorrow morning and says, and it says, I saw Russia rock. It was great, the wonderful gig. I said, what, did you phone home then and get the story for you? He goes, no, I wrote it before I came, and if they don't play, the editor's going to have my knackers.
Unfortunately, one of us got caught short before we went to the gig, and I don't like to say whom it was because it would be obvious, but we came out of the hotel and there were no buses there. So when there were no buses there, I said to Steve, we need to get a taxi, and he said, we won't get one, and I said, give him some money and we will. So I said to the guy, take $5 and we're happening.
Well, the rules of the game are so totally different from the rules that we're used to. That is a bit of a shock to everybody. We have to, you know, we wait for lots of things in England, but we think it's by choice, and here it's, or in Russia it's not. So that you know, that causes people to get somewhat upset maybe sometimes.
As he takes us to this place in the middle of nowhere, we get out, these people pick us up, we're treated like royalty. We get in this gig, they take us down the front row, the lights come down, the lasers come on, the group walk on stage, and we've never seen them in our life.
I just get this, from the people I've spoken to, I get the sense that at the highest level, they like the fact that there are changes, but that on the street it has had no impacts whatsoever yet, really.
I was taking a picture of the cathedral. Suddenly I was shoved in the shoulder by a heavy, and reacting as one does, I turned around and fell into the circle. It was a kind of a KGB circle, I guess, or I subsequently discovered. In the middle of the circle was Gorbachev. And wheeling around, I literally bumped into the man.
Well, I think that the thing that I noticed by my own reaction to the whole thing is that we are terribly attached, really, all of us, I think, to the comfort, the human comfort that we enjoy in England. And that makes me think, really, because I don't think that's necessarily such a great thing.
You want to know, did we pass the test?
Yes, did we pass the endurance test?
You can see
it's a topper.
I have one.
It's the third time I've been to Moscow. First time was 10 years ago. I didn't notice any changes between 10 years ago and February this year. But between February this year and this weekend, I've noticed tremendous changes.
Yes, well, it was an experience. I think that puts it down in a nutshell. I just couldn't believe the reception we got. They didn't want us to come and they didn't want us to go. I think the authority sucks, but the people we spoke to seem to be okay. So we'll go for it.
Yeah. Well, it was different. Indifferent. So I spent quite a lot of my spare time talking to the kids in the street, actual Russian kids, and they seem quite positive of what's happening in Moscow at the moment, in Russia.
It was cheap.
Great on the black market. Some people came back with more money. Did you come back with more money?
Well, I came back with more rubles, but they were spending them, actually.
It's been a lot of fun. It's been a wild and crazy weekend. And so...
No, we did enjoy it, didn't we? Did we enjoy it, Rick?
We did. What was the name of the band again?
You got us there.
It's on that. Hold on a minute. Storm. Yeah, it was Storm. A great... Storm in a teacup.
Storm in a teacup.
Very good. It's the Cossack Choir again.
Immediately, the first thing that strikes to mind is the fact that all the young people, especially my friends before I was about to go, were saying what are the young people in Moscow really like, and they're nothing like what we really thought. They're completely different. They're just like us. All like this, wearing their hats and looking very good. Ha ha ha, like that.
Well, I'm glad I went. I think the groups there at the concert, I like Brigade S the best, even better than Big Country.
Very nice. Hey, cut that man!
I thought I had a jolly good time, actually. I thought it was an experience for everybody. They moaned a lot, but they learnt a lot, you know? to say that I bought it off a soldier
would be a lie.
If you went around Red Square, there are four people with no hats on, put it that way.
And it took us a whole afternoon to achieve.
It cost a lot of money, but it was worth it.
I'm very happy to be home. I'm delighted to be in one piece. It's been the most amazing experience of my life, I have to say. And I'm pretty knackered, to be quite honest, if the truth be told.
I don't know where we go from here, but I'll find something.
To top it.
Well, it's different culture-wise, but it's been a real good time, you know. It's like making history, first sort of stand-up, organised concert, people enjoying themselves and having a good time. You know, it's been really, really good fun. It's been a lot of fun, great.
I was impressed with some things, I wasn't so impressed with other things, but I'm really glad I've been there, and I'll go again. I think the way has been opened now for not only bands like Big Country to go back to Moscow and the rest of the Soviet Union, but for other bands to go to as well, and I think they should go. It's an experience. People out there obviously want rock and roll music, and I think it's up to us to take it there.
I'm glad to be home, but I'm very glad I did the trip, because I don't know, but I'll remember in the morning.
I was disappointed with the press reaction. A lot of people missed the point. They had to sensationalise various things just because that's the way their editors tell them to write. Some of them were drunk, which wasn't exactly a good example to set on any standards, particularly the nature of why we were being there.
But
particularly amusing were the stories about the group being bottled off stage, you know, when, of course, anyone who was there will remember that the hall was totally dry and the journalists were most upset they couldn't actually find a bottle in the hall.
There was certainly a lot of media coverage, some of which wasn't exactly on the group side, but I thought it was from the lower types of national newspaper, which one would expect it from anyway, looking for any nasty angle they can come to. If you looked at something like the Times, at least they gave it a fair account.
I think it's early days to say whether the press achieved has been justified by the expense. I suspect may not.
I've wondered about it a lot, you see. It is almost impossible to tell what print translates into record sales, to answer one end of it. You could feed the thing in the computer and I don't even know then if you'd get the answer. Certainly, everyone in Britain this week is talking about Big Country.
If you want to organise an event like this to launch a project and you say to the media, would you like to come to Amsterdam or Milan or Madrid or Moscow, they'll all say, let's go to Moscow, we haven't done that yet. That's a great idea. But there's no doubt in my mind that there is a limit to which you can do things like this, simply because the economics of it are so horrific.
I have no idea how much the whole thing cost.
An awful lot.
Frightening proportions of financial investment.
I'm not going to reveal the pennies, but it was quite considerable, but I think worth every penny.
More than £500,000?
Not more than £500,000.
More than £400,000?
No, you're not going to pin me down.
Well, I can't give you details of the overall cost.
If I was to believe what I read in The Sun, I would say it would be £500,000, but I know that's not the case.
The cost of the band will have been substantial, and all that was the subject of considerable negotiation before the band left on the trip.
Well, I thought Big Country were very brave to go out there and do it and take 250 people, because it did come very close to being a flop when they couldn't play.
It looked like that thing could have been a fiasco, but it wasn't, and I think, in a way, it inspired the group to put in a greater performance, and I think it motivated the press to pay even closer attention. Their adrenaline was running, whereas otherwise half of them would have probably been asleep during the show. And that sounds cynical, but that's the way half these buggers are.
I think the objective is being achieved. I think you can see in today, looking at the Financial Times, there was a six-column article by Anthony Thornycroft. Very informative, very well written, and something where you wouldn't see Big Country normally, and it's important to get into those areas.
In the event, the band managed to make good the awful start, and the audience soon revelled in their new upright freedom. At previous concerts by British bands in Moscow, the audience had been forced to remain seated, and by the end, there was a dancing, waving, chanting crowd of happy youth. Big Country were bit players in an important drama unfolding a few miles away. But they were proving that rock music could be rousing, therapeutic and fun, something that Soviet youth is only slowly beginning to discover. Just how the visit fitted into internal politics, it was difficult to say. But while so many British bands posture, mixing their music with a little modish political gesturing to salve their consciences, it was inspiring to be at a concert where the performance of the music represented a political act.
I kill the blade, I see. Public consumption of a private man.